the Raleigh James Show. We had scheduled John Goodman, who we will say hello to for a moment here. I have to tell you publicly that I loved the book because of how revealing it was into the personality of Dickie Goodman, as well as the relationship between the two of you, which obviously was so meaningful to you. But when we listen to things like Novelty Records, for instance, or some of the one-shot wonders, or the people who have had a couple hits and then just disappeared, every now and then you wonder, whatever happened to these people? What is it about these people? And without a doubt, the King of Novelty, which you have written, is real insightful into the life of Dickie Goodman, and it's just a wonderful work.
Here's your host, Peter Anthony Holder.
Where it's 212 on CJD. Remember years and years and years ago, there was Dickie Goodman and his novelty tunes that were very, very popular. Like Father, Like Son, John Goodman is on the line with us right now. Hi, John. What did your dad do before he came up with these novelty tunes?
Well, he was a struggling songwriter, and I guess the success wasn't coming fast enough. So he did something crazy, and he broke right into the business.
Did he have any idea when he came out with the first one, which was, what, 1956, Flying
right,
Saucer?
Right.
Did he have any idea that it was going to be the massive hit that it became?
No, absolutely not. In fact, he said himself that he just didn't know any better. He just did it. His idea was, in those days, it was right during the time of Roswell and Hangar 18 and, Area 51 and all that stuff, and there's all this flying saucer stuff in the news, and he just got the idea that it sounded funny to describe an alien invasion by a line from The Great Pretenders, as the flying saucers were too real.
Now, when he first came up with Flying Saucer in 1956, I understand you mentioned earlier the lawsuits. Was it like something like 17 record labels came after your dad?
Yeah, everybody sued him, and the judge ruled that he had created a new work. So it set the precedent that you can sample, and in and of itself, it's not a copyright violation.
There's an entire generation of kids who, let's be honest, don't really know your father's work.
I know, that's unfortunate, and that's why I've made the new tracks to help introduce it to the younger generation.
When did your father... I know your father's passed away. He died in 1989.
Uh-huh.
How long before that did he stop, or was he always doing these novelty tunes to the end?
He really did it right up towards the end. His last record was in 86. Safe Sex Report was the last break-in record that he did back in 86.
Now, I remember when I was a teenager when Mr. Jaws came out, which we'll play a little later on, and that was a pretty fair-sized hit, too, was it not?
Yeah, that was enormous, and because it was, in the 70s, he finally got, more... It seems like it was even bigger than the Flying Saucer, because back in 56, when he did Flying Saucer, there wasn't even an organization in existence that would give you an award or a gold record if you had a huge hit. They didn't even have that yet. So when Jaws came along, by that time, the music, societies were all set up, and he got a gold record and everything else. So it seemed like an even bigger hit.
Now, we mentioned earlier that there were 17 lawsuits when your father first did the original Flying Saucer Part 1. Obviously, some people were very miffed at this, being that the record labels... What about some of the artists? Did you ever hear from any of the artists who actually appreciated and got the joke?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, at the time, once he won the case, the ones sort of coming out of the work, there was a song by Demi Reynolds, Moonglow, and the publisher was complaining that, felt that, he should have been included on Flying Saucer. And in fact, there was an article in Time magazine that said, if you're not on Flying Saucer, you're nowhere. So it became a big sensation. But one thing I would just love to take the opportunity to do while you got me here,
mm-hmm,
is just say, how much it means to me to have this opportunity to be heard in Canada, because one of his gold records was from Canada.
Oh, really?
Yeah, for Mr. Jaws, he also got a gold record for Canada, so I know there's a lot of Dickie Goodman fans there, And there's probably people listening right now saying, wow, this is great, because we haven't heard from it in so long. When you watch the stuff that's on the late night TV shows and hear everything that's on the radio these days, the way they can make fun of anybody or any situation, that kind of freedom of speech did not exist when he first started doing this back in the 50s. And over the years, he was one of the major people that really contributed to that being able to be done at all.
Which, you mentioned your dad didn't do this alone. He worked with a partner, right?
Originally, his very first record, he had a partner, Bill Buchanan.
Okay. And later he went to work by himself?
And he kept doing it. Bill, was like him. It started out where they were both struggling songwriters. They were friends, buddies, and they did this thing together. And Bill, you know, went back into just regular songwriting, but Dad developed a passion for this and continued doing it.
John, I thank you very much for being on the program with us.
Thank you.